4-3-3. Welcome as we gather to worship the Lord together with his people in his house. If you're a guest or a visitor among us, a particularly warm welcome to you. And we invite you to stay and join us for fellowship after the service. A couple of announcements before we begin. One, scheduling announcement for the Girls Club. This week, the Girls Club was scheduled to meet at my house, at the Teamsters' house, on Thursday. But that meeting will be at the church instead. So the Girls Club will not be meeting at my house. It'll be meeting at the church instead. And then one prayer request. Mark Gelderman asked if we would pray for his Oma, his dad's mother. Mark's Oma had fluid in her lungs this past week, was hospitalized earlier this week with trouble breathing. So we pray for comfort and for treatment for her as well. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 95, as we are called together as God's people to come together to worship. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. As we come to worship our God together, let us go to him now in a moment of silent prayer. Please rise. Congregation of the Lord, our help is the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Amen. Lift up your hearts and receive the Lord's greeting. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As the song of praise, we'll sing together from number 122B. Number 122B, my heart was glad to hear the welcome sound. Thank you. This morning our reading of the law comes from Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, as God speaks through his servant Moses to his redeemed people Israel at Mount Sinai, these 10 words, these 10 commandments. And as God's redeemed people, we continue to read these words today. So we read from Exodus chapter 20, beginning at verse 1. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children, to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Having once again heard the law of the Lord together, having heard these words, we're brought together to confession. And our song of confession is number 67b, Psalm 67b.
Thank you.
God, to us show mercy. Yes, indeed, that is our hope. The mercy of God. The mercy of God shown in Jesus Christ to those who were not deserving. And so our assurance of pardon comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, where Paul is writing to the Corinthians, where real sin had been found, where real sin had to be dealt with. And there he writes, "For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death." And praise God for that hope, that life found in Jesus Christ, and that call to godly repentance, to godly grief for sin. And let us come before the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the good news of the gospel. We thank you that there is hope in Jesus Christ for repentant sinners. We thank you that there is pardon, that there is cleansing in the blood of Christ. Father, we thank you for your church. We thank you for the body here in Telqua. Lord, what a blessing you give, placing us in a body, in a family, in a church. And may we never take it for granted. And teach us to encourage one another, to lift one another up in prayer, to see our lives in the body and not just lives lived for self. And Father, we pray for those who have special needs in this week, in this day. We pray for Lainey Boonstra. We thank you for the care that she was able to receive, for the partial hip replacement that she had this past week. Strengthen her in this time of healing. Grant patience to wait on your timing. We pray for Bruce Raffin as he continues to recover from his heart surgery. Strengthen him, encourage him with your word and spirit. We pray for Ev Koopmans as she waits for her pacemaker on April 16th. Give patience as she anticipates the procedure. Father, we pray for strength and healing for her. We pray as well for Mark's Oma and their family at this time. Strengthen her. We pray for comfort for her and for healing. Lord, we also rejoice with those who rejoice. We praise you for a healthy baby born to Will and Mel a week ago. Equip them and all the parents among us to point our children to you, to your gracious word, to live in light of your promises. Father, we pray for your church. We thank you for the singles among us, the many ways in which they serve, serving on committees and serving various groups and clubs and studies, actively being a blessing to those around them as uncles and aunts, as brothers and sisters, lending a helping hand and a joyful smile. Bless them, O Lord, with continued fellowship and service in your body. We pray for those who are downcast, anxious, discouraged about many things. O Lord, give light, give encouragement. Equip us to encourage one another, to walk side by side in many struggles. And Father, we pray as well for Megan Osterhoff as she prepares to do an internship with CCBR, raising her voice for the lives of the unborn. Give clarity in a world of confusion, and strengthen Megan and each one of us to promote life, to see the value of life made in your image, to preach the hope of the gospel to those caught in shame and feeling like they have no other option. Lord, you give hope, and you give healing. May we share that hope. Father, we pray for your word in this day. Give clarity in this day. May we love the church because you love the church. May we join that church in obedience to you, and may we serve, faithfully submitting to the authority that you place in our lives out of love for you. So give us wisdom, give us understanding, open our hearts and our minds to your word today, and shape us more and more into your image in service to you. In Jesus' name, amen. And please turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew. We're going to be looking at the two places in Matthew where Jesus speaks of the church, in Matthew 16 and Matthew 18. Matthew chapter 16, beginning at verse 13, and then we'll turn over a few pages to chapter 18 as Jesus speaks of the church. So we'll read Matthew 16, beginning at verse 13. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. And then turning to Matthew chapter 18, beginning at verse 15. "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them." The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. As a song of preparation, we'll sing from number 119E. Number 119E, "Teach me, O Lord, your way of truth."
Thank you.
I invite you to turn with me to the Belgic Confession, Article 28. Several weeks ago, we finished looking through the Heidelberg Catechism together in the afternoon services. We also finished our catechism classes for our young people several weeks ago as well. And you may notice in the bulletin that I'm offering a class, a profession of faith class, in coming weeks. But as we consider something like professing our faith, being a member of a church, we're going to consider for the next 2 weeks what that means, what we're called to do. Why does it matter that I join a church? What does that even mean? So this week we're going to look at why it's important to be a part of a local church. And then next week we're going to consider some of the blessings and responsibilities of church membership. We're going to look then as well at Article 28 of the Belgic Confession. This is on page 184 in the Forms and Prayers book. Article 28 is on the obligations of church members. We believe that since this holy assembly and congregation is the gathering of those who are saved, and there is no salvation apart from it, no one ought to withdraw from it, content to be by himself, regardless of his status or condition. But all people are obliged to join and unite with it, keeping the unity of the church by submitting to its instruction and discipline, by bending their necks under the yoke of Jesus Christ, and by serving to build up one another according to the gifts God has given them, as members of each other in the same body. And to preserve this unity more effectively, it is the duty of all believers, according to God's word, to separate themselves from those who do not belong to the church, in order to join this assembly wherever God has established it, even if civil authorities and royal decrees forbid, and death and physical punishment result. And so all who withdraw from the church or do not join it, act contrary to God's ordinance. Congregation of the Lord, why should you be a member of a local faithful church? Until recent years, this question, should I join a local church, a faithful local body, hasn't really been that pressing. The more pressing question might have been, for a Christian, which church should I join? But it was assumed by Protestants, by the Roman Church, that a Christian should be committed to a local church. That I'm certainly a member of the universal church, but that's lived out in the local church. That it's in that local church that we then are called to live our Christian lives. There, outside the church, there is no salvation, in the words of our confession. And a strong statement like that is not because we are saved by our church membership, but it's in the church that we hear the message of salvation. It's within the church that we hear that gospel call. It's within the church that Jesus gives that responsibility. In Matthew 16 and 18, we're saved by the blood of Christ. Christ dies for his bride, the church, and we join the local church, faithful church, in obedience to Christ. And so this morning, we're considering the importance of being a member in a faithful local church. And this idea has fallen on hard times in recent years. Now, you can think of a number of reasons why this is a question today. You might think of a distrust of authority. Authority has kind of fallen on hard times in much of our culture. Authority is mocked in many TV programs and movies is out of date, out of touch. Authority can be and has been abused by some. And so for many, they look at the idea of authority and perhaps say, why would I submit to something like that hurts people? Why would I want that? How could I trust that? So sometimes there's a distrust of authority. Another reason, we live in a very individualistic age. A time when maybe we don't need our neighbor as much as perhaps we did in the past. A time when it's easy to kind of live on my own and do my own thing, come home from work and pull into the garage, raise the drawbridge, and live in my own castle, the world kept outside. We're sometimes very individualistic. And so when that's brought into the church, then the question becomes, well, isn't the important thing that I love Jesus? Isn't the important thing that I have a relationship with Christ, that I believe in Him? So why do I need to submit to joining, to becoming a part of a body with people who might hold me back, with people who might slow me down and distract me? I'm better off on my own. Isn't the important thing that I'm a member of the universal church? Another reason might be a lack of clarity. What does the Bible actually teach? After all, where is the text that says, thou shalt become a member of a local church, thou shalt be baptized and profess your faith and commit to a local church for all your days? If there's no text, does the Bible really teach it? And we're going to address these concerns. And as we look at this, if you're a member, I hope that this week and next week gives you a renewed appreciation, the beauty of what Christ does in His church, the beauty of what He calls us to do in bringing us into this body where we can serve Him and grow in Him together. If you are a visitor and maybe wondering, why is this a big deal? Does the Bible really even teach that? I hope this gives clarity as we look at the Bible together and say, what does the Bible teach? And young people, as you consider profession of faith, or maybe as you consider other life choices, I'm going to be going off to college soon, I'm going to have big changes coming. Is it really such a big deal? Or can I just put it off and sort that out later in life? I hope that you see that the church should not be an optional add-on to our Christian life, something we may join or may not, but should be vital, central to how we're called to serve Christ together in His church. We should not be content merely to attend church, but we certainly don't want less than that. Hebrews 10:25 reminds us to gather, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near, we read there. But this morning we consider the blessing, the importance of binding yourself to a local Bible-believing church, a faithful church in a visible and vital way. I'm less concerned with the word membership than I am with what it signifies. Because sometimes we hear the word membership and we think of our library membership. As long as I pay my dues, I get the books. Or a gym membership that you tried once, pay the dues, and you have the right to, if you ever so desired, go and run on the treadmill. But church membership, or you might think of a commitment or accountability or a covenant, church membership in a faithful local body is deeper. It involves a public commitment on your part to Christ and His church, and a corresponding commitment of the church to you, a relationship, membership, commitment between the individual and the local church. It's an outward reflection of an inward love, love for Christ and his people. We embrace Christ. The context in which we do that is in a church. So this morning we ask, what does the Bible say about joining a church? And as we look at this, we see that the Bible assumes church membership. The Bible assumes church membership. Now, there may not be a verse that says, thou shalt join a local church, but when you look at the Bible, there is this clear, consistent picture that to be a member is to be in a living, local, faithful church. That's where this call to be a member of the church is lived out. And this morning, I want to highlight five different ways we see that. First, you see it in the pictures used to describe the church. There are many, many pictures that we see in the New Testament that describe the church. Pictures like a body, 1 Corinthians 12, united under Christ, the head, with the members as limbs and legs and arms and hands and feet. We see a picture of the flock united under the shepherd. You might think of 1 Peter chapter 5, a temple built together out of living stones in 1 Peter chapter 2. Pictures that emphasize there's a connectedness, there's a unity, that these stones aren't just set out to be little individual lone ranger stones, but to be built up together. The body is not fingers and toes in isolation, but united to the body, united together in service under Christ the head. Or a flock gathered by the good shepherd. And as we come closer to the shepherd, as the shepherd calls his sheep, they come closer to one another. So there's this picture that to be in the body is to have this relationship with the other members. You see it as well in the second place in the word for church, ecclesia, church. It means assembly. And that's the word that Jesus uses here, the two places he uses it in Matthew. It means assembly. It means to gather. So the church, the assembly, is those who are called to assemble, to gather. Now, so far, this just establishes that we're called to gather. All these pictures in that word, ecclesia, they highlight that. But does this mean, as we confess, that all people are obliged to join and unite with it, keeping the unity of the church by submitting to its instruction and discipline, by bending their necks under the yoke of Christ, in the words of the Belgic? Does this mean that we actually should be members, or that we just need to assemble and attend? Is it so important that we would risk death rather than be separate from that local body? If it is truly what Christ calls us to do and where Christ meets with his people, then that means it should be exactly where I want to be. Because if it's where Christ calls us to be, well, then we obey Christ. We love Christ. We follow his command. But does Christ call us to join that church visibly? And I think here it helps to look back to the Old Testament. As we continue to build this picture, and it's getting clearer. The Old Testament, the third place. Was it clear who was a part of Israel? And it's the clear, consistent witness of the Old Testament that to be a part of God's people in the Old Testament is to be a visible member. So if you think of all the places where covenant breaking, the result is being cut off from God's people. So for instance, Genesis 17 verse 14 says that if you refuse to be circumcised, you've broken God's covenant and shall be cut off from God's people. And there's many places in the Old Testament where where covenant breaking led to being cut off. So there was a clear dividing line. It was clear. Either you were part of God's people, part of the nation of Israel, or you were outside. You were part of God's people, but if you rejected that covenant, you rejected God, you would be visibly cut off, put outside the camp. There were certain boundary markers that helped establish who was a part of Israel and who was not. Food laws, laws about what you could wear, about who you could marry, who could inherit, laws about who could come to the feasts and be a part of that assembly. So, for instance, it wasn't enough to simply say, well, I read the law, the Torah. I believe in God. So, yeah, I'm part of Israel. I'm part of God's people. And you actually had to become part of God's people, like Rahab, like Ruth, like Uriah the Hittite. And this would mean circumcision and joining God's people and living as part of God's people. So, for instance, Exodus 12:43 speaks of eating the Passover, and it was very clear, no foreigner shall eat of the Passover. But if you were a foreigner, and you came and you saw God's people and said, I want to join. I want to be a part of God's people. Well, verse 48 says, if a stranger shall sojourn with you and would keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised. Then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native of the land, but no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. So in the Old Testament, to join God's people is to be a visible member, publicly committed to God's people, to the nation Israel, the church in the Old Testament. So then, I believe it's a very clear picture in the Old Testament. But the question is it clear in the New? Or does it all change? Does this change in the New? Because we know that we don't necessarily have to be part of the ethnic nation of Israel and live in the promised land, and we don't have to be circumcised. So has the picture changed in the New? But in the New Testament as well, we see that picture that to be a member of Christ's church is to be a member of a visible, local, faithful body. Indeed, much of the New Testament doesn't make sense without it. In the book of Acts, for instance, we see reference to particular numbers. You knew who was part of the church and who wasn't. Acts 1:15, the company of believers was about 120. Acts 2:41, after the Pentecost sermon, 3,000 souls were added that day. They worshiped together. Again, people knew who they were. Acts 5, there's this clear line. You knew that there were those who were in the church and those who were not. And there was this fear. Those who were not didn't dare join the church in Acts 5. There was this clear understanding, this clear line, not based on ethnicity and the land, but in belief in Jesus Christ. The visible expression of that faith as they were set apart by baptism and profession of faith in Christ, as they proclaimed Christ's name, as they ate the meal that he gave, a meal in which Paul says that there are necessary divisions in 1 Corinthians 11. Not the divisions that they were making between the rich and the poor and the haves and the have-nots, but divisions in order that those who are genuine might be recognized. So Paul recognizes there's a legitimate distinction here. If you don't believe, you shouldn't be coming. You shouldn't be taking this meal, he says. There needs to be that division. In the New Testament, we also see local identifiable bodies such that letters could be written to them. Think Paul's letters or the letters in Revelation to the seven churches with seven particular needs, struggles. In the New Testament, to be a member of Christ's church is to be a member of a local church. And indeed, much of the New Testament doesn't make sense without it. when Paul writes to the church in Corinth and tells them to put out the sexually immoral man. It only makes sense within a context where there's a body in which he can be put out of. He later states in his letter to the Corinthians, "For what have I to do with judging outsiders? Is it not those inside the church whom you are to judge?" And the elders in Corinth and the Apostle Paul have a particular concern for the church, for the purity. The notion of elders requires a local body, watching over a particular flock. Paul speaks to the Ephesian elders in Acts 20, verse 28, and says, "Pay attention to yourselves and to all the flock, in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood, to guard that flock against fierce wolves." Because that's what he says next. Fierce wolves are coming, and you need to be on your guard for the sheep in your flock. And Peter says something similar in 1 Peter 5, "To the elders among you, be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care." Elders are called to care for particular sheep. Now, Hebrews 13 shows the weight of that call. Hebrews 13, 17 says, "Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have to give an account." One day, the elders and I will have to stand before God and give account. Who are we giving account for? The sheep that we're called to watch out for, to care for. You remember one of the reasons that the idea of membership has fallen on hard times is the abuse of authority. Remember that God takes that abuse very seriously. Some of the harshest words of judgment are spoken to shepherds who abuse the sheep. It's a weighty responsibility. So pray for your leaders. Pray for those who are called to watch over you. And submit to your leaders, because you are also called to be faithful to God's commands for your life. Are you submissive to the authority that God has placed in your life? Paul reminds the Thessalonians, "Respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you and esteem them very highly in love because of their work." The fact that authority is sometimes abused, that sometimes it's abused horribly, doesn't mean that we get to cast off authority and say, I can do it on my own. You have no authority over me. Rather, the answer is the proper use of authority. And one of the reasons for the Reformation was the abuse of authority. The Roman Church abused the authority of Christ, took to themselves what belonged to Christ. But the answer wasn't to reject authority and say, I'm done with church, I'm done with listening to anybody. The answer was proper authority under Christ, who is the head of his church. We're never called to be anti-authority. We're never called to be spiritual lone rangers or churchless Christians. The fifth place that I'm going to mention is discipline. The practice of discipline requires church membership. And this is part of our witness to the world. Who represents Christ? Just this week, I had a conversation with an unbeliever, with another brother, in which we made a comment, something to the effect of, as Christians, we believe that this is wrong. And his response was something to the effect of, but I know Christians who believe and live and teach exactly the opposite. So how am I to know who's right? And when we see that, there's this confusion in our witness. There's a confusion if we proclaim Christ but then live in a way that Christ has not commanded. If we proclaim Christ and say, yes, I'm a Christian, but I'm going to live how I like. So if you worked with someone, for instance, who claimed to be a Christian, but thinks that lying, stealing, cheating on his wife is no big deal, well, that third coworker looking at the two of you would say, I don't really get them. They're not that different than the rest of us. Who's to say what being a Christian is really all about? Well, we'd take that to the Bible, of course, and say, well, the Bible teaches this. But the church also has a role here in church discipline. In Matthew 16, Jesus gives the keys of the kingdom to Peter, the apostles, consequently the church, that part of the church's role is to use the keys, preaching of the word, the exercise of church discipline, and say, this one is not. This one is not part of the church. In Matthew 18, Jesus says, if your brother sins, tell it to the church. That only makes sense if there's an actual body to tell. And if he refuses to listen to the church, let him be as an outsider. Christ gives his church this role in exercising the keys of the kingdom, in declaring this one is a kingdom citizen. As the gospel is proclaimed, as the good news is given, that good news is not become a member and be saved, but the good news is believe in Jesus Christ for salvation. But the other side is if you refuse to believe, then there is no salvation. If you refuse to submit to the lordship of Christ, then there is no salvation. And so then that key of church discipline, it's that public declaration for the sake of Christ's witness to the world to say this testimony, this life that rejects Christ is not part of the church. The church guards the reputation of Christ in church discipline. And sometimes the church gets it wrong. But that doesn't change the fact that Jesus gives that authority, delegates that authority, that binding and loosing in representing Christ before a watching world and saying, this one belongs to Christ, and the one who's denied Christ is living a lie. Again, you do not become a Christian by joining a church. You become a Christian by submitting to the lordship of Christ, repenting of sins, believing in him, trusting in him. No one's ever been saved by joining a local church. And there will be those who were part of a local church, a faithful church, to whom Christ will say, I never knew you, because they never believed in him. So to an unbeliever, I wouldn't say you need to join a church. I would say you need to believe in Jesus. But the place where you will hear his word proclaimed is the church. The place where you will experience the fellowship of believers who can walk with you and encourage you is the church. The place where we're called to live our Christian lives, to submit to the authority that Christ places over our lives, is in that body for which he died. So we need to believe in Jesus. But the place where you profess that faith and live it out is the local church. If Christ loves the church so much that he gave up his life, then that church should also matter to us. A churchless Christian, one author writes, is a contradiction in terms that needs to be put right as soon as possible, because that is where Christ calls us to live. And next week, we're going to look at more of the blessings and responsibilities that entails. But in the meantime, if Christ has such care for his church that he dies for her, and that church should matter to us. If Christ gives his church authority to represent him on earth, then that is where we should want to be. If Christ saves and sanctifies believers in the context of a local church, where else would you want to be? So in an age that celebrates individualism, this is the important thing, is me, my health, my happiness, my relationships, we're called to seek the good of others. I'm a part of a body. I serve in that body. I serve the other members in service to Christ, my head. I'm committed and I'm accountable to the authorities that Christ has placed in my life. In an anti-authority age, we're called to submit ultimately to Christ. It's our highest authority. But because we submit to Christ, we also submit where he calls us to submit, in the church. And in an age of confusion, we're called to clarity. The clarity of the Word of God, the clarity of joining a local body, the clarity of witness. In a confused world that says, what is a Christian? What does a Christian look like when we see so many different things? When it seems like Christianity is whatever you want it to be. Remember, Christ gives authority in his church to declare, to bind and to loose. This one is rejecting Christ by his word and deed. And that gives clarity. That we can't just live however we want. We can't just do whatever we want, but we're accountable. Christ dies for his church. He saves and sanctifies believers in the context of a church. And where else then would we want to be? Let us pray. Merciful God and Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for the blessing that you give. We thank you that, as Christ says, he is building his church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Father, we thank you that we can be a part of a church. We can see the blessing of being a part of a local, faithful church. Lord, teach us to set aside our own desires and to ask, how may we serve? How might I live for the glory of Christ in the body that he's called me to be in? Help us to praise your name through our words and our testimony. In Jesus' name, amen. As a song of response, we'll sing number 403. Glorious things of thee are spoken. Number 403. Thank you. This time we worship the Lord through the giving of our gifts, and the offering is for the work of the Calgary Youth Summit. As a song of praise, we'll sing the first five stanzas of number 404, The Church's One Foundation, number 404, the first five stanzas.
Thank you.
following the Lord's blessing, the doxology is stanza 6. Now lift up your hearts and receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.